Because it's American Heart Month and Valentine's Day, we've decided to dedicate our February Safety Chat series to ways you can protect the ones you heart. We'll look at tips for every kind of household and discuss safety strategies that you can use at home, outside the house, in the community, and in your body. There's no way I'd miss out on sharing some tips for heart-healthy living this month. To kick things off, we're going to look at proactive ways to make kids of all ages safer. And surprise, your Safety Chat guest this month is me. Today, I'll be sharing tips and resources to help protect youngsters from the time they're in the cradle all the way on up to the car. But there may be a few kidlets that pop up here and there with their own takes on how to stay safe. And if you've got some safety or heart-healthy tips for kids, go ahead and share them in the comments. Use hashtag SafeWiseHeartsYou, and your tips may make it into a Safewise article, an upcoming newsletter, or even a future video. And don't forget to subscribe to this channel while you're there. There are so many ways to protect your kiddos in the home that we've got an entire section on Safewise.com dedicated to it. We cover everything from baby-proofing to cyberbullying and how to talk to your teen about things like distracted driving and other safety issues. You can find links to helpful articles and resources in the description below. But right now, we're going to do a quick refresher about fire safety in the home. I have to tell you, I have seen way too many tragic headlines about house fires in the past couple of months. So this is a topic that I've decided we need to double down on. I also asked some kiddos what they would do if there was a fire in their house. Let's see what they had to say.
You have to get out of the house.
I would run out of the house.
The kids that I talked to all knew that they had to get out of the house, but here are some important reminders about how to get out of the house safely during a fire. If you hear the smoke alarm or see or smell smoke, yell fire as loud as you can and keep yelling until an adult or an older kid responds. You want to get the attention or wake up everybody in the house. And if you have a phone with you, call 911. Next, it's time to do what those kids recommend and get out. But first, feel the door and the doorknob to see if it's hot. If you feel heat, that might not be the safest way for you to get out. Yell for the grown-ups and let them know that you need to find another way out of the house. Usually, that's going to be a window. If you're on an upper floor, make sure that every bedroom on those upper floors has a fire ladder and that the kids know where it is and how to use it. If you can't safely get out of a room, do what you can to keep the smoke and the fire outside. Close the door and use blankets, towels, clothes, whatever you can find to plug up any cracks or vents. If you have access to a bathroom and you can wet those materials before you stuff them under the door or in those like heating and air conditioning vents, even better. You should also hang some kind of a signal, a piece of clothing or a blanket out of the window to let rescuers and other people know that you're in that room and you need help. Now, if you are able to exit the room, the important thing that you have to do at this point is stay low. Smoke rises and it's usually the most dangerous and deadly part of a house fire. So your goal is to stay below the smoke. This might mean that you gotta get down and crawl on all fours. And if you can't get low enough, if there's no way to get below the smoke, you wanna wrap your mouth with clothing, a towel, a blanket, something that's gonna help filter out that smoke. Again, if you can make that material wet and then wrap it, that's even better. Now, we hope this doesn't happen, but if you or your clothing catches fire, stick to the old standby we all learned when we were kids. Stop, drop, and roll on the ground to smother those flames. When you're finally out safely, go to the designated meeting spot that your household already agreed on and stay there until everyone is out. And if you haven't called 911 yet, now's the time. You can get more information on setting up a fire escape plan for your household from Katie in a recent installment of Ask Safewise. Protecting your kids when they're out in the yard, across the street at the neighbors, or even on their way to school can be nerve-wracking because they are out of our direct control. But wait, I mean, were they really ever in our control? Let's be honest. Anywho, one way to send those nerves packing is to use a kid's GPS tracker. Those of you that have followed me for a while know that these are one of my favorite gadgets. And we've got all the info you need to know both on this channel and on Safewise.com. Those links are just waiting for you down there. Plus, you can check out my videos about how to find the right tracker for your family, see my interview with a mom and why she was looking into a tracker for her 7-year-old, and check out how much me and my little tester loved the TikTok 4 smartwatch. If you're nervous about not having eyes in the back of your head or x-ray vision to see through the neighbor's fence, then a kid's GPS tracker might be the reassurance you need to let your wee one stretch their independence safely. As kids grow, so do their transportation options. Personally, I loved it when my kids could get where they were going without having to use mom's taxi service. It wasn't my favorite job. But whether it's riding a bike or driving a car across town, these new faces come with their own safety concerns. Here are my number one rules for safety behind the wheel, whether you're on two wheels or four. Rebecca's bike safety rule number one, wear a helmet. When I was about 13, I got hit by a car on my bike. I was knocked off the bike, rolled across the hood of the car, and landed on the ground, knocked out, cold. I was super lucky. The only outcomes I had were a broken finger, a pretty significant bump on my noggin, and I could no longer spend the night at my friend's house. I had to go home. On top of my own personal experience, my son in elementary school had a friend who ended up in a coma after an accident without a helmet. And one of my best friends worked at Primary Children's Medical Center in Salt Lake City for years. And I have to tell you, the tragic things that she saw as a result of accidents where kids weren't wearing a helmet continually just broke all of our hearts. So I say don't risk it. I don't care if it's not cool, and I don't care that I never wore a helmet when I was a kid and I'm just fine. It's an unnecessary risk, and it can truly save your child's life. Rebecca's driving safety rule number one. Every day, over 1,000 people in the US are injured and 9 killed because of distracted driving. So for brand new drivers, I say don't even risk going the hands-free route. You need to pay attention to the road and you need to gain experience out there before you can juggle multiple things going on. Phone calls are distracting. Navigation directions, as much as I love them, are distracting. And texting can be downright deadly. Just as we earn the privilege of getting that driver's license to start with, we need to earn the privilege of driving safely with a phone in the car. Finally, here we are at some ways to help protect our little ones and their hearts from disease and dysfunction. Now, if this seems like a problem that only applies to middle-aged folks like me, I'm sad to say that is not true. About 1 in 25 kids between the ages of 12 and 19 already have hypertension. That's high blood pressure. And 1 in 10 have early signs of it. So those numbers aren't moving in the right direction. The truth is, when it comes to heart health, I'm probably not going to tell you anything that you haven't heard before. But coming from someone with a huge family history of heart problems, heart health is something worth revisiting. So here are a few reminders. Starting at age 3, make sure your pediatrician checks your child's blood pressure regularly. There's no time like the present to create heart-healthy family routines for regular physical activity. Instead of sitting around watching a show, go out for a walk, take the dog around the block. Whatever works for your family, get moving. We used to have dance parties every Wednesday at my house when my kids were little. So find what works for your family and get your groove on. And finally, build early habits to eat nutritious foods. Or build habits early to eat nutritious foods. The CDC has some really good healthy snack strategies that you can try. Make heart health a priority now and avoid lifelong health problems. The earlier you start, the easier it is to skip the cookie and reach for the apple. Believe me. Well, I hope that these tips to help protect the ones you heart motivate you to take some action this month. And if you don't have kiddos at home, don't worry. I've got a whole month of simple strategies to help everyone and all types of households create a safer life at home and in your community. And don't forget, if you've got a heart healthy tip for kids, let us know in the comments below or on any of our social accounts with the hashtag SafeWiseHeartsYou. Until next time, stay safe.